Whether it's wild goats reclaiming a Welsh town or coyotes ambling down Ontario city streets, wildlife and the natural world are experiencing this lockdown much differently than we humans are. Does this hold any lessons for us bipeds going forward? Let's ask. In Santa Barbara, California, Leah Stokes. She's assistant professor in environmental politics at the University of California, Santa Barbara. And we're glad to have you on TVO tonight. Professor, how are things going in your world?
Oh, it's pretty good in California, especially in Southern California where I am. There aren't too many cases, and we've been seeing the benefits of some cleaner air down here. So overall, in Santa Barbara, we are pretty lucky.
We have definitely seen the pictures of Los Angeles looking cleaner, and I will get to that in a second. But let's just start with some examples in which the natural world might be thriving right now because we're not as out there as we once were. What are you seeing?
Yeah, so there's been some reporting of animals reclaiming areas that humans have been in the past. So bobcats or, for example, they saw coyotes running across, I think, the Golden Gate Bridge in San Francisco. So in some urban areas, wildlife is certainly coming back. I feel like I talked to a friend the other day and they said there was a bear in their city. So, you know, those kinds of stories are becoming more common as many people stay in their homes.
I think bears in the cities is a bit of a problem, but if it's just more coyotes, more beavers in the, you know, in the rivers and that kind of thing, are we good with that?
Yeah, I think that wildlife in general is something that, you know, we can all appreciate.
Okay, let's talk about Los Angeles, because it is true. We have seen the pictures of the skies over LA looking cleaner than I think I can ever recall at any time in my life. Besides the obvious of being able to breathe more easily, what are the side effects for human and animal well-being that this now provides for?
Yeah, so I think a lot of people are seeing the benefits of cleaner air. A lot of the air pollution that we have in cities, including in Los Angeles, but certainly also in Toronto, comes from cars. So people driving around with internal combustion engines and burning fossil fuels, that creates not only carbon pollution, but also local air pollution, smog and things like that. And I think what people might not understand is that we don't need to all stay home to have cleaner air every day. If we just use the technology that's already available, that's electric vehicles and public transit, we could have cleaner air every single day. So I'm hopeful that some people are starting to see the lesson in actually using the clean technology that we have.
Let me do a quick follow-up on that, because auto manufacturers have often said, look, with all the pollution control devices we have in the modern made car, we are not the source of the polluted skies over the big cities of this world. True or false?
That's definitely false. Including in Toronto, for example, where there have been coal plants shut down and a lot of air quality improvements have happened after that, a lot of the existing air pollution that's still continuing is coming from cars. And that's certainly the case in the Los Angeles area. So the fact is that we need governments to be supporting electric vehicles. And unfortunately, when Premier Doug Ford took office, he immediately got rid of the rebate that was propelling Ontarians to be buying electric vehicles. So right now, only 1 in 50 cars that are sold in Ontario are electric vehicles. And we really need our governments to be supporting these technologies more so that we can have clean air every day.
The federal government in Canada did reinstate some of those subsidies, although perhaps not as generously as the previous provincial government here in the province of Ontario did. But the amount of car buying right now is nil virtually. I mean, it's insignificant. What do you think could take place if subsidies to buy electric powered cars were to be reinstated in a bigger way?
Well, you don't have to question that too much because British Columbia and Quebec have kept in place their rebates for electric vehicles. And right now, 10% of cars that are sold in British Columbia are electric vehicles. Contrast that with Ontario, where the rebate went away and we're only seeing 2% sales. So you're right, the federal government created a $5,000 rebate after the Ontario rebate, which was $14,000, went away. So we do have some coverage from our federal government, but we're really not seeing the kind of adoption rates that we need to be seeing to not only tackle air pollution, but of course also take on the climate crisis.
Okay, so that's one way in which we can make more permanent some of the gains that we have made during the course of this crisis. What about, for example, the benefits of working from home more in the future compared to the way we did it in the past? What are the possibilities there?
Yeah, you know, I think that some people are seeing that maybe they don't need to be traveling as much as they were. That's certainly the case for me, for my work. But unfortunately, things like airplane travel is actually a really small percent of global emissions, as well as Canada's emissions and the United States emissions. In the US, just 3% of emissions in terms of carbon are coming from airplane flights. So when we think about tackling the climate crisis, we have to be thinking about much bigger segments of the economy. And that's really why I focus so much on cars. People are going to be going back to work eventually, and we need a transportation system that allows them to get to work without having to pollute carbon dioxide or other kinds of conventional air pollution.
Well, let's take a look at another sector. I don't think tomorrow everybody in this world is going to become a vegetarian, but if more of us did, what impact would that have?
Yeah, so there's been a lot of focus right now on the fact that there are big COVID outbreaks within meatpacking areas. And of course, this original virus is believed to come from a place in China where animals are being used, for example, for food and for other purposes. And so, yeah, there are big questions about the way that our meat system operates and how it could be more sustainable. I think, you know, if people really want changes, it's not just about the individual changes that they make, it's also about government changes. So what kinds of policies do we need to have in place for our meat supply chain to make sure that workers, for example, are protected and are not contracting coronavirus just by going into work? Because there have been a lot of clusters, both across the United States and even in Canada, of outbreaks at these meat packing facilities. And so I think we have to ask ourselves questions about how we can make our food system more ethical for everybody.
Well, I think if memory serves, the Cargill plant in Alberta had to be shut down entirely, but go ahead and answer your question. How would we have to transform things in order for it to be safer and more environmentally sensitive afterwards?
Yeah, so I think that in general, there's a lot of focus on making our agricultural system more environmentally friendly. The agricultural system does contribute carbon dioxide emissions and other kinds of pollution to our environment. And so we probably need more government regulation to be putting rules on these systems, because we have had a growth in industrial agriculture in the past 50 years, and that is associated with a lot more pollution and a lot more carbon dioxide emissions. So I think that we should be making changes to our food system to help address some of these environmental problems.
Now, we have heard some stories from the agricultural sector about, for example, farmers deciding not to plant crops on a part of their field since they're not sure that they can get them processed and then to market anyway. Does that help the planet?
Yeah, so there's been a focus in recent years on the fact that farmers can really be part of the climate change solution. And that's through practices like no-till agriculture. The fact is that when plants grow, right, that would include crops, they create roots, and those roots have carbon in them. And if you remove the plants and leave those roots in the ground, and then you do not till the earth, meaning turning it up year over year, then theoretically some carbon can go into the soil, and that can help with the big carbon problem we have. Because right now, actually, we have carbon levels in the atmosphere that we have never experienced before. There was a new record set, I believe, last week. And so we really need to be thinking about ways that we can draw down carbon from the atmosphere back into the soil. And one option is for farmers to become a partner in that through these sort of no-till agricultural practices.
Well, okay, but if you've got a no-till agricultural practice, how do you make any money?
Yeah, I think even more than that, the problem is you need carbon to be stored in the earth for very long periods of time. When we talk about fossil fuels, we're talking about taking a geological carbon storage, right? These are things from hundreds of thousands of years ago that we're taking out from the ground and we're putting into our air and our oceans and our land. And so if all we do is store it back in kind of the topsoil of the earth, that isn't really putting it down all the way underground. So I think there are limits to which the agricultural sector can be partners in this. But the fact is, to tackle the climate crisis, all sectors of our economy need to be making changes. And there really isn't time to delay any longer.
Leah, let me ask you about our decision makers in general. You know, for maybe the most dramatic time I can ever recall, they are listening to scientists right now and they are making decisions. Essentially, the scientists are telling them what to do and they're doing it. Of course, it relates to health and the pandemic. I wonder whether you think this opens the door to the potential of decision makers, again, listening to the scientists as it relates to climate change. And maybe instead of dragging heels, they actually go out and get it done.
Yeah, that's a great point, Steve. You know, our scientists have been saying for many decades now, well over 30 years, that climate change is a crisis that is on our doorstep. We've already warmed the planet by 1 degree Celsius, and those impacts are already being felt across Canada, across the United States, across the world. We're having more intense storms, drought, heat waves. These are affecting all kinds of people. And so we do need our governments to start stepping up. And there have been all these really interesting studies that are estimating how much our carbon emissions are falling as a result of this pandemic. And the best estimate, including a paper that just came out yesterday, is about 7 to 8%. But what decision makers need to understand is that to limit warming to 1.5 degrees Celsius, what we need to do by 2030 is actually cut our emissions by about 8% every single year. So our decision makers need to recognize the scale of this crisis and all the economic policies that we will be rolling out to deal with unemployment and a recession. All of those policies need to be directed towards climate change because there is no more time to waste. We need our governments to be driving this emission reduction every year.
We know the skies are cleaner right now, but do we have any, I mean, we're 2 months into this thing, so it may be too early to tell, but can you tell what percentage decline in pollution there is right now as a result of this pandemic?
Yeah, so when it comes to carbon dioxide pollution, that's exactly what scientists have been working on. And they believe that it's going to be around an 8% decline globally in carbon dioxide pollution around the world. And that's a really big drop. That's the biggest drop in carbon dioxide that we have ever experienced. But unfortunately, it's likely to be temporary because during the recession, we saw a drop in carbon dioxide and then we saw a really big rebound. So what we need is our governments to help us lock in those reductions. Because as I mentioned, we need a reduction at about that scale every single year to limit warming to 1.5 degrees Celsius.
And we certainly, we don't want to cheer for a new pandemic every year to get us to that number. So we got to figure something else out, right?
Yes, exactly. No, the coronavirus is not really a silver lining for climate change or for air pollution. Those are some side effects to what's been happening. But really, we don't need to all be sacrificing at the scale that we are in order to be tackling the climate crisis. In fact, if our government was in the driver's seat and was setting policies to help us deploy clean technology that we already have, that's like solar panels and electric vehicles, and you know, supporting the agricultural sector for things like the no-till farming that we talked about. If our governments were doing that, then we could be seeing reductions and all of us could be living normal lives. So addressing climate change is not about sacrifice. It's actually about economic policy.
Yeah, but I do want to gauge your level of either optimism or pessimism right now. There's the sense that, you know, when the house was on fire, both your national government, our national government had to rush programs out there, emergency response benefits, subsidies for business, rent backstops, wage backstops. You know, they got those things out in relatively fast order in order to help put out the fire. You know, but I got to ask you this. Once the fire's out, you know, people tend to have very short memories on these things. And I wonder whether you're concerned at all that, you know, government will just go back to business as normal, as opposed to using this as a real, you know, moment in history to change the way we do things. What do you think?
That's a great point, Steve. There was a really excellent report that looked at all the G20 nations and what they're doing during this stimulus moment. And unfortunately, only 4% of the policies that the G20 countries, including Canada, are doing are green, only 4%. And in fact, just as many policies are propping up the fossil fuel industry and are dirty. 4%. So you're right that a lot of governments are not taking this as an opportunity. I will say, however, that the Trudeau government has done one really excellent thing, which is that rather than continuing to subsidize the fossil fuel industry in the Western provinces, one thing that they've done is they've put $1.7 billion towards cleaning up wells that have been abandoned from a lot of the historic fossil fuel extraction in places like Alberta. And so I think that that is a way that we can think about how we reboot our economy. How do we get Canadians back to work, but do it in a clean way? And we really need to all be demanding that governments around the world, including in Canada, make green spending and green stimulus the top priority.
You say it's up to governments to do that. And do I take it from that that you think they have the lead role to play as opposed to individuals and how we might live our daily lives differently?
Absolutely. You know, I was an undergraduate at the University of Toronto and I studied psychology at that time. And I ran a program where we tried to get people to save energy, to live in a more environmentally friendly way. And after running that program for several years, what I took away was that that's just not a big enough lever. We as individuals don't have enough power to really change the society. All of us are living in a carbon intensive society. We were born into that, and our goal is to not die in a carbon intensive society. And the only way to do that is to have governments set policy so that all of us can make better choices, so that it's easier to buy an electric vehicle, let's say, for example.
I really don't want to come off like a killjoy here, but you'll appreciate that I do have to ask these uncomfortable questions. And for example, we do see some cities around the world are now noticing the fact that there's considerably less traffic on the roads, and they're thinking, well, we can expand the sidewalks, or we can make, you know, busy city streets, given the lack of traffic, more friendly for people. But one gets the sense that as soon as this pandemic is in the rearview mirror, you know, water finds its level. Things are going to go back to quote unquote normal. How worried are you about that?
Well, actually, there's some really good news about that, Steve. In Berlin, for example, it's really difficult to get a new bike lane built. And what's been happening is things that would normally take 10 years to decide on are happening in the matter of days. And the government there is making it clear that they're going to keep those bike lanes after the pandemic. The same is happening in Italy and in Greece. A lot of governments are saying, hey, let's reshape our cities a little bit and put in more bike lanes and pedestrian areas. And, you know, as a former cyclist in Toronto, I can imagine that that would be really fantastic to be having more bike lanes built in the city and to have more protected space. And a lot of the reasons why people don't bike, again, is not because they're bad people or they don't care about climate change. It's because they don't feel safe on the roads. So that's why we need infrastructure in place so that people can feel safe biking alongside cars. And we need that infrastructure to be permanent. So at least in a few places, we're seeing governments make that infrastructure permanent.
Gotcha. Leah, I got about 30 seconds left here. Let me ask you one last question, which is, again, we have seen such a dramatic and fast response to this pandemic from governments all over the world to protect people from the worst ravages of it. And yet, you know, year after year, decade after decade on the issue of climate change, so slow, so sluggish, not fast enough. What are your thoughts on the sort of psychology behind that decision making?
Yeah, so I actually just finished a book called Short-Circuiting Policy, which looks at why we're behind on addressing the climate crisis. And it isn't about what individuals are doing. People don't need to feel guilty. They need to be looking towards institutions in society and why they're continuing to prop up pollution. So electric utilities, fossil fuel companies, and their relationships with government are really the key reasons why we are so slow in terms of taking on the climate crisis. So we need our decision makers to be listening less to fossil fuel companies and more to everyday people. Because I've done research myself that shows that Canadians are really worried about the climate crisis, and we need our governments to be listening to everyday people and not to polluting industries.
Leah Stokes from UC Santa Barbara, we are so grateful you could spare some time for us on TVO tonight. Thanks so much and be well.
Yes, you too. I've listened to the show for a long time and watched it, so it's wonderful to be here with you today.
That's so kind of you to say. All good wishes.
You too. Bye.
The Agenda with Steve Paikin is brought to you by the Chartered Professional Accountants of Ontario. CPA Ontario is a regulator, an educator, a thought leader, and an advocate. We protect the public. We advance our profession. We guide our CPAs. We are CPA Ontario. And by viewers like you. Thank you.